Good afternoon, Trinidad and Tobago, and welcome to yet another edition of the Sports Drive Program here on Heritage Radio 101.7. Quite a busy week we've had so far, and looking forward to a very exciting weekend of sporting activities and even more exciting week ahead as the Trinidad and Tobago's senior men's team continues their preparations for the CONCACAF Gold Cup 2015 in the United States and the Russia 2018 World Cup qualification that begins in November. With us in studio today is a very special guest. We are quite fortunate to have with us head coach of the Trinidad and Tobago men's senior team, Mr. Stephen Hart. Stephen, welcome to our program and thanks for being here.
Thanks very much for having me.
So there's quite a lot, as I mentioned earlier, happening in terms of, you know, we look at the ICC World Cup cricket and the West Indies are getting set for what really has been their, will be their biggest challenge of this current World Cup as they get prepared to face one of the favourites to take the title, New Zealand. Across the board, you look at, you know, what is happening in the Champions League, and we have, you know, further action happening in the European competitions with our own Dennis Lawrence. His Everton going down quite badly today to Dynamo Kiev, 5-1 in their Europa League clash. We have Kenwyn Jones at Cardiff City. Interestingly, he has been left out of the national senior men's team for the upcoming game against Panama. But he has not been dropped. It is, we want to make it quite clear. And Coach Stephen Hart, in his correspondence over the past 24 hours, made it quite clear that people like Kenwyn and some of the other overseas-based players who have not been included in it for the squad, in the squad for the game against Panama, they have not been dropped. But Coach Hart is going to use this game as an opportunity to have a further look at some of the homegrown talent that we have here in Trinidad and Tobago campaigning in the T&T Pro League, as there are as many as 10 uncapped players who have been brought into the squad. And obviously he's looking to see how they adapt and how they face the meet the challenge of international football, and Coach Hart will tell us a bit more about that today and his decisions to bring in some of the under 20 players into the team. The national under 20 team captain Shannon Gomez has earned his first international senior call up and will be hoping to make his debut for the Soka Warriors next Friday at the Atobolan Stadium, Trinidad and Tobago versus Panama, kickoff time 7 p.m. Stephen, obviously a lot has been said over the last 24 hours, a lot of eyebrows raised as well in terms of your selection for this team. Tell us about, you know, how you got to this final 22.
Well, for ever since I've taken the job, I've asked for the opportunity to be in a position where I can have a camp mainly for local based players, but I wanted an international game, and this is sort of ideally the situation, because I'm not going to have much time leading into the Gold Cup. So having Panama, which we found out recently is bringing their basically their full lineup, allows me the opportunity to work with these players. I mean, I'm only going to have 4 days, but that's sort of really reality if you're going into World Cup qualification. You're only going to have 4 days preparation in most of the games. So it gives me an opportunity to look at a number of players that over the last year and a half have shown the kind of consistency that you know, that I've been looking for, and obviously there are positions in the team that are open for fighting for.
Aside from the fact that you've called several uncapped players and players that the Trinidad and Tobago public, on outside of those who follow the Pro League, would not be familiar with, you've kept faith, or you've decided to call back the likes of Kaleem Highland and Kevin Molino, who for your 2018 campaign, they're going to really be they're going to be some of the people you're going to depend on, especially in the middle of the park, to get to really carry the team throughout the campaign. Tell us about the thinking behind that.
Well, I mean, it's no sort of guarantee that those players are going to be there. What I thought was I wanted to have 4 or 5 foreign-based players that have worked with me on a sort of consistent basis, and they know how I work, and they can pass it on to the players coming in, and they would also act as sort of guidance on and off the field as to expectations and how things are done. And I thought that was very important. I had the opportunity to bring in Sheldon Bateau and Highland, Hoyt and Molino. And I thought that 4 would be sufficient for what I'd like to do.
And from the list of home-based players, you have some guys there who have that experience of having played outside. We see Uriah Bentick, who has been in the U.S. for some time. He's earned his first call up to the senior team, but he has been at Under-20 World Cup for Trinidad and Tobago. Willis Plaza has been outside in Belgium and other parts of Asia. And also Jan Michael Williams and the two goalkeepers, they continue to be your most two most experienced goalkeepers. You know, looking at that, and then Mikkel Williams as well, who's had experience in Finland, are you feeling rest assured that, you know, these guys can give us something decent come Friday? Because, I mean, let's be fair, we're in front of a Trinidad and Tobago public that expects that, you know, come Friday the 27th, they want to see results, and some of them still do not understand the process of what it takes to get a team prepared for international qualification or for a World Cup campaign. What is your feeling of this? Because, I mean, let's say, for instance, the team, I mean, Panama here, we know they're no pushovers. They really have excelled over the past couple of years. They bring in a full-strength team. What would you have to say to people who have expectations for Friday 27th?
Well, I mean, the public always have expectations when a team steps onto the field, and we don't step onto the field talking about development and all of that. We go into the game playing to get a result, and that is normal. But I have a job to do. I have the Gold Cup coming up, and I have World Cup qualification coming up. We have not played football consistently on FIFA dates, so this was an opportunity to give players an opportunity to create competition within the squad for places, and quite frankly to try and fill some spots that have been sort of weaknesses, for lack of a better word, in the squad. So I have my own priority, and if you really were to sit back and think about the game, it's an exhibition game. And if you are frightened to go into those sort of games and experiment and take risk, then I see no point in us discussing any form of development of the Trinidad and Tobago football team. We simply pick who we're comfortable with and go play games.
Well said. In saying that, it must be very exciting, and the opportunity being presented to players like Shannon Gomez, Nivel Hackshaw, and Ikem Andrews, who obviously impressed in the previous CONCACAF qualifying round. What are you hoping to see from these players, and what do you feel about them coming into the national setup now, and being able to see what they hold in terms of the future of Trinidad and Tobago football?
Well, I would like them to get the experience from a senior standpoint. I was very impressed with how they carried themselves on and off the field at the Under-20. I was there with them all along. They understand the importance of rest, recovery. They took in ideas very, very quickly and tried to apply it on the field. And those are qualities that you're going to need. So they're going to come into the camp. They have a fair chance to try and push to get into the lineup. I've already showed confidence in the 22 players that I've picked. It's now for them to take on the challenge of now getting on to the starting 11.
What can you tell us about players for many who would not have been following the local leagues? It's going to be the first time they'll be hearing about the likes of a Dwayne James or Tyrone Charles or even a Jamal Jack from Central FC. You've followed the Pro League very closely this season. You've seen these players week in, week out. What is your take on what, you know, what they can bring to the table?
Well, I mean, I have to make it clear. There are other players that I would like to pick, but I can't pick everybody.
Right.
And it's a one game situation. I was really hoping that we would have two games on you know, both FIFA dates. So it's a one game situation. And those players have demonstrated some qualities that I think, you know, on a sort of consistent basis in the league, and I'm very interested to see how that transfers itself into an international game. And quite frankly, Panama is going to be a full test of concentration, focus, and the application of our techniques collectively and individually in this game.
You mentioned the fact that we were hoping to have two games within the window. Panama, obviously their head coach, Hernan Gomez, he's coming with a full-strength team, and 3 or 4 days later, they're preparing for a second friendly against Costa Rica as they continue the preparations for the Gold Cup. When you look at the whole setup in terms of we're preparing now for the Gold Cup. We know who we're going to face in our opening game against Guatemala. Then we face Cuba and then we close off against Mexico. You were in Philadelphia for the draw. What was the feeling there in terms of what did you gather in terms of the enthusiasm ahead of the CONCACAF Gold Cup? And I mean, it's in a year of World Cup qualification as well. How does this fit into the whole scheme of things for us?
Well, I got the sense that most of the countries that are involved are looking at World Cup qualification. There's, I mean, the magnitude of the investment that they have in their national teams. I mean, if you look on the respective websites, you can already see who they're playing in June and who's their exhibition game in July for the Gold Cup, going into the Gold Cup. So they already have that sort of platform to build upon. We are not in that situation at the moment. But for some of them, their World Cup qualifying starts earlier than others. Some of them, it will start actually before the Gold Cup. So, you know, they are in a different situation than I am. I don't start World Cup qualification till November. But in my eyes, that is my priority. Yes, the Gold Cup is important. We have to, that sort of tournament competition, that sort of the stress that that brings on everybody is essential for the growth of the team.
Talking about what the other teams already have in store for the next few months or so, I mean, we know the challenges that we face here in Trinidad and Tobago, not just for football, but for all sport. We've had some ongoing discussions with the current Minister of Sport, the Honourable Bern Sancho, but football continues to face the challenges that we faced over the years. Is there anything that you can tell us based on your planning and what you hope to sort of put in place for the next 6 months or so leading up to the qualification? What could may possibly be in the pipeline for us? Let's say, for instance, you want to play a couple games in preparation on the FIFA dates. What do you have in mind for this? And how do you intend to approach the preparations now? Let's just say, for instance, we don't get that sort of international competition that we're looking for.
Well, let's hope we get it. I mean, if you don't get it, then you're rolling dice. But what I would like is the Pro League finishes in May, May 20th, I believe. Once that is over, I would like the players to have a very short break, and then we go into a very intensive camp for leading up to the two dates in June. I have asked the administration, I want two games in June on the FIFA dates, and by then, after those two games, I should have a good idea of the squad, and then we go into the United States, play one more exhibition game, and then enter the Gold Cup. That for me is what is essential if you are going to challenge. Last Gold Cup, I came in the job late. I didn't get a single preparation game. We had a...
Mind you, Trinidad and Tobago, without even a single preparation game, Stephen was able to lead the team to its second-best ever Gold Cup performance, reaching the quarterfinals against Mexico. It was the first time we went beyond the group phase since 2000, when Bertil Sinclair led the team under the captaincy of Dwight York to the... Sorry, under the captaincy of David Knackett, straight through to the semi-final against Canada. But Stephen, you look at this scenario now. You're preparing for Guatemala. You've had experience playing against Guatemala while you were head coach of Canada. How do you sum up our group?
If you look at the Gold Cup and how the Latin teams in particular start, they always start very, very aggressive. They do very well in the opening games. If you look at the last Gold Cup, El Salvador came out flying against us. We were fortunate in the first half to be 1-1.
Yeah.
That seems to be a trend, because this is going to be my sixth Gold Cup, five as a head coach, one as an assistant coach. And that seems to be the trend with the Latin countries. They start very, very strong. So the opening game for me is going to be the game that decides how we move forward and try and get into the knockout phase. After that, of course, it's Cuba. We know each other very well. The last two games we have tied, the last two games. So It's a sort of a game that hangs in the balance. For some reason, Cuba seems to be a bit of a nemesis. I would like us to get over that hump, right? And then I'm really excited about challenge against Mexico.
Sounds great. For us, generally, when you look at the talent that is available to us home here, you're getting a game where you're going to see the core of the home-based professionals. As you mentioned earlier, there are some players, other extra players that you would like to look at. A lot of people have been talking about, you look at Jamaica and the talent, their disposal of talent from the UK or English-born players or other born outside of Jamaica. For us, we don't have the privilege of having so many players that have been born in England and continue to play at a high level. How has that process been for you? Are you keeping your eyes out? You have several contacts across the globe. Is there anything on the horizon for us in terms of players who may be knocking on the door for Trinidad selection with a passport?
Well, there are a few players, and their names have been thrown around. I think the difficulty at the moment is to approach players and bring them into an environment right now that has had a lot of media press about our professionalism, and it's difficult to convince. I mean, without calling names, I spoke to one or two of the players, and that was one of the questions. Yes, there are players out there that I would like to coax to come on board, and I will continue to speak with them, especially when the time is right, moving into the right sort of time period. But I would also like to know that I could speak with confidence about our road ahead, because if they ask me what is the plan, right now I can't answer them with 100% guarantee that this is what we're doing in June, this is what we're doing in July, and then Gold Cup, etc., etc.
Well, Trinidad and Tobago, you're hearing it directly from the head coach of our national men's senior team, Stephen Hart, as we look ahead to next Friday's friendly international at the Atabolan Stadium, Trinidad and Tobago versus Panama. Kickoff time 7 p.m. Tickets are already on sale at $100. You can't go wrong. It's the start of the long weekend. You can get your tickets at the All Out Restaurant, Queen's Park Oval, at Kenny's Sports Shop, Fan Club, Movie Town, Port of Spain, Trinity Mall, and Gulf City. For those of you in Tobago, at Heritage Sports in Scarborough, also Ram Singh Sport Hall in Couva, and Econo Supermart. So we want to obviously give you the opportunity to win a couple tickets on today's program to attend that game. So if you're listening in and you're interested, you can reach us at 628-4846 or 628-3896. You're going to answer a very simple question from Mr. Hart in relation to this game against Panama for the chance to win a ticket to attend next Friday's friendly international, Trinidad and Tobago versus Panama. So you've also been hearing as well, Trinidad and Tobago, about some of the efforts that are being made around the clock for Trinidad and Tobago football and our preparations for the World Cup qualification, Russia, that begins for us in November. We all remember the euphoria that was created back in 2005-2006 when Leo Benhakker led the team to the World Cup finals in Germany. I'm quite sure we would like to experience that again, but it takes so much other than just putting 11 players out on the field and hoping to win a game. There's a lot of behind-the-scenes planning, a lot of advanced planning that needs to take place, and when you compare what some of our opponents in the CONCACAF region, what they already have in place, it really leaves a lot to be desired in terms of where is that support for Trinidad and Tobago football from corporate T&T. It has been lacking for just over 5 years or more, sadly so, but I mean, the fact is we have ambassadors that continue to represent the country and try to fly that red, white and black proudly, doing so with limited resources, but obviously holding country very close to heart. Coach, a lot of people have asked about your take in terms of the TTFA right now is without a technical director. We have been so without a technical director for several months since the resignation of Anton Corneill. Obviously, they're asking, what is your feel about the way forward for the TTFA? And a lot of people think that you can have a lot of influence on our development, overall development. You looked at, you assessed the under 20 team and the under 17 team that recently came out of CONCACAF qualification. What do you think it will take for us to have that sort of proper holistic approach for the development of our football and the preparation of all our international teams for competition? I mean, when you compare Canada to some of the rest of the CONCACAF. I mean, Canada has to be commended for having a proper program in place. Even while you were there as technical director at one point and working with the national teams, they've consistently qualified for FIFA Youth World Cups. Trinidad and Tobago still continues to face that uphill battle.
Well, Canada has the opposite problem. Because the youth development, male and female, is decent. The problem is at the senior level, because there's no real football in Canada for seniors. So there's a massive drop off. I would say over 80% of the players drop out after the age of 18. So they have the opposite problem. We still have a strong grassroots program in this country, in the sense that there's a love for football, everybody still plays it, but we don't have a process, we don't have a development sort of model, and when I say a development model, I'm not just talking about the teams that are in the FIFA competition, because that base is really too small. If you just pick 26 players to train for an under 17, that base is small. If you're looking at that base, which is the international base, you need some sort of screening program at about the age of 13, and then a very strong development program from about 14-15 right through to the under 17 on a consistent basis, and then the same sort of pattern happens with the next age, moving into under 20. But I think the objective should be to increase the overall base at the younger age. The more players you have coming through, it stands to reason you will have greater numbers in selection. And because of the geography of the country, it should not be that hard to do. You can have several under 15 teams, or let's say teams between 13 and 14 years old in various regions. But they need to compete. They need to compete, either compete against each other, or they've got to get the competition. Very similar for the national teams. Those national teams at 15, I think I was reading the other day that Panama and United States under 15s are already going to play international games. And you cannot teach experience. Those experiences, those players have to go through themselves. There's a lot of experiences to learn, traveling on an aeroplane, how you eat, how you sleep, hotels, your rest, playing on different surfaces. There's a lot of experiences to gain, the lack of comfort from, being away from home, et cetera, et cetera. Not to mention the game itself. Mm-hmm. So all these things need to be put in place, and I certainly don't have all the answers. We have enough people here with the knowledge that we could sit down and come up with something for the country. Now it needs investment. Those countries are not doing it. They're not developing a small program and playing in house and getting the results they're getting. Right? There's a significant investment on the road towards their national teams, right? So it comes back to the same question all the time. It's not only an investment, you're asking players and families to invest in terms of the sacrifices they make to get their children to the fields and everything that goes through with the support, and then you're asking the youngster to train 4 or 5 times a week, which is what goes on in Canada and Panama and the United States, and play one game on the weekend. And that is not Stephen Hart's program. That's what's happening around the world. And that sort of, you're asking them to put in that sort of investment, but there's another side of the investment that needs to be looked at, and it's how they're clothed, how they're fed, how they travel, etc., etc.
Stephen, a couple of weekends ago, you made the trip down to San Fernando to view one of the academies, the Anthony Sherwood Football School at the Gulfview Recreation Ground. Recently, we saw former national striker Stern John. He's going to get involved with the T&T Football Sevens Academy, where he's going to basically try to focus on working with the youths from 5 years old straight up to maybe 16, 17. How important are things like this for the development of our game, and what is your take on something like this happening? Tony mentioned to me that, there's an absence of possibilities or opportunities for players between that 6 to 11 year old category to get regular practice matches. We have the pro league teams that have the respective under 15 teams, under 17s, etc. But if you're not with a pro league club, the cry is that there's not much opportunity for kids to get that opportunity to play matches. It's all well and good to have them training and preparing, but to play matches. And I understand now that the T&T Football Sevens Academy and clubs like even Queen's Park and Sherwood's Academy are now trying to plan matches between themselves outside of official competition, just so that the kids can get an opportunity to play and to try to be competitive from that early level.
Yeah, I mean that's extremely important. They're at a stage where they're sort of learning to train, and not yet at that stage where they're training to train and training to play. So they're now learning to train, but they also have to be rewarded with games, and I think that's very important. I spoke to both technical directors of Queen's Park and Sherwood Academy, and they're right. They need to have that balance between practices and training and game. But I will say that the ratio of practice to game has to be significantly in favor of practice and training in comparison to games at a young age.
So, Trinidad and Tobago, we have with us a head coach of the national men's senior team, Stephen Hart. He's in studio with us right now. We're discussing the way forward, and we're going to take a short break and return in a couple minutes.
Boosted, we're fresh, and we're connected to your hearts. Heritage Radio 101.7 FM. Now you can check us out on our website, heritageradiott.com. Check out your favorite announcers, see special features and upcoming events, past photo ops too, updated newscasts, and much, much more. Listen to us from any part of the world. Like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. We're just a phone call away on 628-4846 or 628-3896 to a happy song. Get connected to your Heritage. Heritage Radio 101.7 FM. HeritageRadioTT.com.
Break the corner. Let's go. This is the man, Errol Piru. The man, the real Kaiso man from Heritage Radio 101.7 FM. We rock in your Saturdays with people like Dr. Leroy Callis, the Black Stalin.
I just feel it's a party.
Gypsy.
Really in a brass band.
The mighty Sparrow. Get Chanel.
We use the whole lover's lane every blessed Saturday night.
You just name it, we got it. Right here on Heritage Radio 101.7 FM with the big man in the business, Errol Piru. Don't forget, it's real Kaiso.
Every Saturday from 2 to 5 p.m. right here on Heritage Radio 101.7 FM.
Good afternoon once again, Trinidad and Tobago. I am Shaun Fuentes, your host for today's edition of the Sports Drive. With me in the studio, head coach of our men's national football team, Stephen Hart. Stephen, you know, we've spoken so much over the past 45 minutes or so about, you know, football in Trinidad and Tobago. But I was just kind of reminiscing a bit about, you know, what transpired back in 2005, 2006. And I remember in a recent conversation with yourself, you mentioned to me, you described that particular era of the late 80s, the 90s, leading up into that campaign in 2005. You described that era based on the players that we had. You remember the likes of David Knackett, Jaron Nixon, Anthony Rogier, Marvin Andrews, Russell Latapy, Dwight York, Stern John, who was on top of his game. These were players who were seasoned professional players based outside of Trinidad and Tobago, and some even based here in Trinidad, the likes of Arnold Dwarker, Angus Eve, etc. Now you have the challenge of trying to qualify for our next World Cup. Right now we have players who are based in Europe. We have Lester Peltier out in Slovakia. We have the Batos and the Highlands in Belgium and other parts of Asia, some parts of Europe, but not such a prominent presence of players in the UK leagues that, you know, I recall when I had to be following the exploits of these players for regular updates in the press, that you know, on a daily basis, you would see our players grabbing the headlines in some of the newspapers in the UK press. We're not that fortunate as of now. We have players who are doing quite well, but there's not that overwhelming presence of players who can walk into a national team right now. How are you dealing with something like this? How do you compare what transpired back in those days as to what we're now facing here?
It's a discussion I had at length with Leo Beenhakker. We talked about it a lot when he first saw this sort of generation of players in Florida when he came in for the Gold Cup, and we talked about it at length because, of course, at the time I was on the outside sort of looking in. Your heart is not directly involved. You mean you're supporting, but your heart is not really involved. I wasn't involved in the team. And if you look at that generation from the team, Bertil Sinclair had a fantastic team in 2000, and it was really the generation that we thought would get us to a World Cup, and unfortunately, I mean the nature of tournaments, you know, we never really got over the hump. We never did qualify. And then we got the tail end of those players moving into the qualification. But if you analyze the situation carefully, you had a number of players that were playing consistently in very competitive environments. Right, and this is important. You had two fantastic goalkeepers fighting for one position.
Actually, three, because you look at Kelvin
Jack, yeah,
Shaka,
exactly.
And Ince were three top of the line goalkeepers.
Exactly. So you had that sort of competition there, and for me, competition, the environment is what drives it, and then you had tremendous leadership. In Lawrence and Marvin Andrews, you had tremendous leadership. Then you move on. You go into the midfield area, and you, of course, you had Dwight, you had Sternjohn, you had
Russell.
You had,
there.
Well, I was just going to, and then you had a very special player that even at his age could come off the bench and change the game as he did in the Guatemala game.
Right.
That piece of magic. So you not only had players that were seasoned and had been through a lot of competition and the stress of competition, etc., but you also had players that were leaders that can galvanize the group, and then you had very, very special players that teams had to pay attention to. So you know, there was a sort of a sharing of the resources when you play the opposition. They had to figure out how to stop Dwight, how to stop Stone, how to stop Russell, and that made it very, very difficult for them. But when you only have to really focus on one or two players, then the opposition, you know, they feel less threatened. But the most important thing for me is that you had a group of players that were playing consistently at a very, very high level. And if it wasn't at a high level, it was an extremely competitive level. Now I have a situation right now where I have potentially three center backs, all internationals, all who have been consistently playing for me and now playing in Asia. Now, I would love to have those players, but they have to fly 30 plus hours to come to Trinidad and Tobago and play a game. That's a number of time zones. And if you consider that you need X amount of days, 4 days for every time zone, by the time they play the game and reach back, they still haven't acclimatized to Trinidad time. So it's a situation now where I have to consider very, very carefully if those players should be made available to Trinidad and Tobago. And that is a very difficult decision to make because they are quality players, they are quality young men. But it's a challenge, and you know, there's a old saying, you can only work with the tools you have. But it's a very different situation than we had in 2005.
You talk about that challenge with the players. With all that said, in terms of the generation of players we had for the 2006 campaign, as opposed to now, we still have some players who I think you're really happy to have in your squad. But is there some sort of consideration, or do you think there's some way of us communicating with these players? I mean, I know they want to play for the country, but they also have to look after themselves. So if there's a better contract for somebody in Vietnam or Thailand or wherever in Asia, South Korea, as opposed to something closer to home. If it is that day, it's going to affect their chances of playing for a country or playing in a World Cup. Is this something? How does a player now consider his options?
Well, I sit down and I talk to the players, very openly. I explain things to them. I don't want anybody to not be able to feed their family. I understand the situation, but they also have to understand my situation.
Right?
So I talk to them. I let them know it's going to be difficult. I want you to be part of the squad, yes. But there's certain factors involved that make it very, 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 very difficult. I mean, the last Gold Cup, I remember Sion Power playing a game, and he came to me after the game and he said, Coach, I'm done. He needed time to recuperate from all the travel, and then he just traveled straight in and was training, and he played, I think, the opening game and a bit of the second game, and he was totally professional. He said, I'm finished, and he needed some time off. So it's a situation where I will have to continue talking with them and being in contact with them and see what is the best sort of solution we can come to.
So, well, fans, you're hearing it straight directly from the mouth of Stephen Hart as he talks about his challenges trying to compose or put together the best Trinidad and Tobago team to represent us on the international stage. And when you hear of some of these challenges, then you really cannot argue with the fact that he's welcomed 10 uncapped players into the senior men's team for next week Friday's international friendly against Panama at Borland Stadium at 7 p.m. Several newcomers in the squad are Neville Hackshaw, Shannon Gomez, Ikem Andrews, Jumal Williams of W Connection. We have Dwayne James of Naughty Stars as well, Uriah Bentick, who really seems to be a bit of talent for the future of Trinidad and Tobago football. He's at Central FC now. He has been campaigning in the USA for some time. He went to a FIFA Under 20 World Cup with the national team. We have the experience of Justin Hoyt and Sheldon Bato. They've been recalled as well. But you look at, you hear of the challenges that we face in terms of preparing to face the best of CONCACAF. The man at the helm right now, who is he has these challenges to deal with on a day-to-day basis, is none other than Coach Stephen Hart. Stephen, how do you compare what a Panama or, let's say, even a Guatemala, they face similar challenges? I mean, you look at the Panama team, some of their players, they have players from across the board. You're talking about players from Poland, Hungary, Uruguay. But when you look, though, you see a lot of their players are based in Central and South America, which means that they're closer to home. Is there an avenue for our players now to look at, to consider, if you want to play? I saw recently we had a couple of players going off to El Salvador to play in the league there. I'm not too sure what you think about the level of football there for our players at this point in time. But how can we deal with this situation?
Yeah, I mean, I'm always a little bit surprised that we don't have agents that deal more in South America. The Colombian league is an excellent league. I was actually in Venezuela for one of their finals about 3 years ago. It was a fantastic game to watch. Sold out crowd, good level of football. A number of Colombians are playing there as well. And of course there's the Mexican league that's a decent league. Panama does have the same sort of problem in that they only come in here with two players from Panama, I think. Mm-hmm. Everybody else comes from abroad, but their players are coming from Europe.
Aside from that too, they're playing consistently. They just recently played our international friendly against USA earlier this year, whereby this is going to be our first game for the year. And it means that they're accustomed a little more with facing with the players and the travel arrangements. They're a little more accustomed to it now than we are. But at the same time, something must be able to be done in terms of our administration and our communication with our players and our potential players to understand that if you want to represent the country and you want to give it a great shot, certain things just need to be done.
Yeah, of course. And you need to play games. And once Trinidad is and Tobago is playing games, then you find the players want to play. I have no problem with the players. I mean, they've been fantastic. Yeah, you have the little player problems that you expect to have. But the players, they train, they put their heart and soul into it. I love their passion. Eh? But there's not enough games to drive them and to create the competition within the squad to advance us. And this is what you need to do. And if Stephen Hart is not sitting here, I will guarantee you whoever is sitting in this seat would say the exact same thing. You need to play football. The coach, Schaefer of Jamaica, is complaining to me that Jamaica isn't giving him enough games, and they've played 12 more games than us before we had played them in the CFU final. You know, so it was strange for me to listen to him complaining that he's not getting enough games, and you know, they're playing far more consistently than we are.
In terms of our setup, I saw recently that you're going to be in, for probably the first time since you've taken over the job, you're going to have a full-time trainer involved with the national team. How important is some of the additional resources for an international team to prepare for such a long haul, that marathon run of World Cup qualification?
Yeah, I think it's extremely important. I need some scientific assessment of all the players. I need to know where they're at. I mean, the average today for a player is about 10 kilometers a game. Hey, and a lot of that is sprinting, and I will guarantee you we're nowhere near to that. So I need some sort of scientific evidence of each individual. I need to be able to track them in games better, to see where, you know, what's their potential and when they're reaching their peak. So I brought in
Tobias Otley,
and he's going to assess them over the next few months and put them on various programs once they're finished with their pro clubs, and hopefully I can get some kind of measurement other than my staff and myself, as to, you know, where they're at.
Well, Trinidad Tobago, you're hearing exactly what is required for our national teams to be fully prepared. You know, we heard all the cries and all the applause for the response or the support that our national women's team received just prior to their all-important qualification campaign in November, December of 2014. But I can tell you what, bringing in additional members of your staff, your nutritionists, proper training officials, psychologists, etc., mere days before a game is not going to help you qualify for a World Cup, as was evident last December. We did all these things at the end, all the efforts were made, but Trinidad and Tobago just realized too late that this is what was necessary. And still, after all that, we gave up a goal just before the end of the game, and there went our dreams of qualifying for a World Cup, Women's World Cup in Canada later this year. In saying that, we don't want to have to endure the same thing again. We don't want to just reach so close to qualifying for the Russia 2018 World Cup and realize that, you know what, Panama, USA, Costa Rica, and whoever else, even possibly Jamaica, were doing more important things or doing the right things before we did, and because of that, we failed at the last hurdle. So, Coach Hart, as we approach the end of today's program, what are some of your parting words looking ahead to the Panama game? What would you want to leave us with?
Well, I'd like this to be our start. And what I mean by our start, the supporters of Trinidad and Tobago football, come out, give the players a push, you know, show them that you are behind them, because they are making sacrifices. And I can guarantee you we're going to do our best. This is our first, I'm labeling this Panama game as our first stage of preparation for World Cup qualification.
Such a pleasure having you on the program today, Stephen. I want to wish you the very best. And again, Trinidad and Tobago, come out, support the Soca Warriors next week, Friday, 7 p.m. at the Bowling Stadium. You can get your tickets at the All Out Restaurant at the Queen's Park Oval, Fan Club, Movie Town, Trinity Mall, and Gulf City, Econo Supermart, Ram Sings Sports World in Coover, if you're in Tobago, at Heritage Sports. And of course, feel free to contact the TTFA at 623-9500. Let us know what are your intentions. If you want to get a batch of tickets, we're going to have the Love Until Rhythm section there to warm things up for the start of the long weekend. Enticing football action down at the Ato Bowling Stadium. Stephen, all the best, and we will stay in touch with you.
Thank you very much for having me.
This is the Royal Bungie. I am a supporter of my country. Time now the candle is bright, ready for the fight. None of them think could out me. I said,
I am the royal bungee. I am a supporter of my country. Right now the candle is bright, ready for the fight. None of them think cut out me. Alright now, people take pride in the side. And just bruise now and not divide. And just get on board for the ride. Cause right now we heading for the Germany tide. So just drive negative from your brain. Forget the bad, let the good vibes remain. You know the girl, it like the top plane. Cause the warriors winning this game. So I say stand up for them, stand up for them. TSTT just stand up for them. Bungee darling, wanna plan up for them. So car warriors to the end. I say stand up for them, stand up for them. TSTT just stand up for them. Bungee Gallin wanna plan up for them. So car warriors to the end. Everybody know. Full stride, full stride, full stride, full stride, full stride. Just aim for the goalpost. Full stride, full stride, full stride, full stride, full stride. Know you're trucking with pride with full stride, full stride, full stride, full stride, full stride. Just take all the time, cause it's full stride, full stride, full stride.
Okay, Trinidad and Tobago, welcome back to the closing minutes of today's Sports Drive edition. We have another special guest on the program with us right now, none other than footballer Dwayne James. Dwayne has earned his first call-up to the national senior team for next Friday's friendly international against Panama. Dwayne, how are you feeling at this time, having heard the news this week?
Sean, I'm not hearing you clear. Can you repeat that question?
Can you tell us, how do you feel about your call-up, first-time call-up to the national senior team for next Friday's game against Panama?
Well, as you know, it's the first time, so I'm very excited to play. First time earning my first cap for the national team, so...
A lot of people wouldn't know your name too well unless they're actually following the Pro League, but I for one can say that you've been knocking on the doors for so long. You've continued to, you've labored on for the last few years, and finally that opportunity has been presented to you. How excited are you to team up with your family, Kevin Molino, and other members of the national senior team?
As you say, Kevin Molino, we just got off Skype, you know, he congratulated me on the first call, so he and all himself, he's excited for me as well.
What do you feel like having the opportunity to work with Coach Hart and to come into a national team setup? How are you preparing yourself both mentally and physically for this right now?
Well, getting advice from my younger brother Kevin Molino, he said, you know, just come on, be yourself, prepare to work hard and put your best foot forward.
And of course, you will be comforted by the fact that you have your brother in the setup there with you. You're going to have some nerves without a doubt, because it's the first time you're into the firing line very early against a quality opponent in Panama. You followed Panama in recent times. You've seen their success at the CONCACAF level. What are your feelings ahead of this game next Friday?
Well, as you know, football is a game is played on the field and not by paper. So a team will look good. You never know what can happen, you know. So I'm just coming out to train hard and hopefully we come out with a victory against Panama.
We have 10 uncapped players have been called to the senior team by Coach Hart. What do you think this says for the Pro League in particular? We don't want to get too complacent and think that, okay, the Pro League is really on top of its game right now, but it shows that there has been some form of progress. And what would you have to say to your fellow teammates on behalf of the home-based contingent in terms of getting into this squad and the opportunity to play against Panama? What would you have to say to them, to these guys?
As I told the players in Northeasters, consistency. You just have to be consistent in every game you play and keep doing the right thing. You never know who's looking on.
Dwayne, as we come to the close of this very short impromptu interview, tell Trinidad and Tobago a little bit about yourself. We know you've been playing for several years now. You've come through the youth system. You've been in the US for some time. Tell us a bit about who Dwayne James is and how we can, you know, what can they expect from you come March 27th.
Well, Dwayne James, you know, came out of Arima, based in Carinage, playing, trying out with different teams in the highest level in the MLS, fought in Kansas City. Went on to training with teams in Orlando with my brother Kevin Molino in Orlando City. And, you know, unfortunately, due to injuries, nothing really came out of that. But very aggressive player, you know, always up for winning victories and up for new challenges.
Such a great note to end this evening's Sports Drive program. Dwayne, thank you so much for being on today's program. We want to wish you the very best. Keep the red, white, and black flying. And we're looking forward to seeing you next Friday.
Yes, thank you, man.
So, Trinidad and Tobago, we've come to the end of today's edition of the Sports Drive program. I want to remind you, next week, Friday, football takes the center stage at Toboland Stadium, Trinidad and Tobago versus Panama. Panama coming with the full-strength team to take on Stephen Hart's men. Kickoff time is 7 p.m. We look forward to seeing you there at the Atobolan Stadium. Tickets again cost $100. Come down, start the long weekend, support Trinidad and Tobago football. I am Shaun Fuentes, wishing you a very safe and happy remainder of today and for the rest of the week. Have a successful and keep striving, Trinidad and Tobago. Good evening.
We committed to the mission, ready for any kind of situation. Hear me now.